You put the shepherd over this flock, Lord. God bless his family, Lord. Bless every family that's represented here today. Oh, God, bless them, Lord God. When they lie down, bless them when they rise up. Oh, God, bless them when they go in, bless them when they're going out. We thank you, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
If you're not free, here's your chance to get free. Jesus. Hallelujah. You might not feel your freedom. Hallelujah. But God is a God of action. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I promise you, if you just praise him. Hallelujah. Because he loves you so much. He loves you so much.
Oh,
sing. You make my life feel brand new. You're amazing. You make my life feel brand new.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, you love me too much.
Come on, put those blessed hands together for Shantae, Floyd, and family. Come on, God is so patient. He's so loving. He's so kind. How could we not worship a God like that? Amen, amen. Come on, continue to bless the Lord for them. Well, family, this is a time we've set aside to celebrate all of our visitors. Listen, if you're visiting with the Rose Hill family, come on, lift up your hand. Let us see you. Wave at us, all visitors, all visitors. Amen. I see you. I see you. Listen, on behalf of our senior pastor, Pastor Danny M. Donaldson, Lady Sherman Donaldson, and the entire Rose Hill family, we just want to say welcome. We thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to come and fellowship with us. Listen, family, if you're around them, come on, give them a pound, celebrate them, tell them it's good to see you in the house today. Amen. Come on, let's bless the Lord for them one last time. Amen. Well, family, does anybody need a word in this place today? Amen, amen. That's what I like, hungry people, hungry for the word. Well, our senior pastor is in the house, amen. And I know that the Lord has given him a word that's literally going to change our very lives. But before he comes, Sister Shantae is going to lead us to the throne. Amen. So let's receive her and her family before he comes by clapping our hands. Come on, let's thank God for him.
Glory. Got to contain myself. I'm trying to stay on schedule. I'm sorry. I will bless thee, O Lord, with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise, and I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. For you have been so good to me. Lord, you've been a real good friend of mine. Say this.
Amazing. Oh, when I think of all the time
rest of my life. Your great name I will sing, of your great name, for you are Christ the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Song says, I'll sing of your goodness. You are Christ the Lord. Is there anybody in the building that can testify of the goodness of the Lord? If you can testify of his goodness, why don't you take 10 seconds and just give God a praise, give God a shout, give God a hand clap, give God a run, whatever you want to do, however you want to praise him. Now listen, everybody lift your hands and say, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy and your kindness. Now do this, say, towards me. Tell them, I can't speak for my neighbor. I can't speak for my friend. I can't speak for anybody else. But say, for your love, for your grace, for your favor, and for your kindness towards me. Listen, I'm going into the word, but I don't believe that it's a coincidence. I don't believe it's ironic that Sister Shantae and the Ford family were singing about the goodness of God. Last night when I was sitting down to study, sometimes I can't study until I get myself in the right space and place. So sometimes I have to listen to worship music and get myself. And I was listening to this song that talked about the goodness of the Lord. And she sang about the goodness today. But here's the thing that it said. It says, Lord, your goodness is chasing me. Now watch this. Many of us are chasing after God's goodness. But watch this. When you know who you are in Christ Jesus, the goodness of the Lord starts chasing after you. Somebody throw your hands up and say, the goodness of the Lord is chasing after me, chasing after me. The blessings of God are chasing after me. Oh, stop. Stop, stop. Y'all gonna make me preach. Here it is. I've been teaching on relationships. And I'm taking the whole church through relationship counseling. Now listen, I don't want you to limit this to what I'm saying, marriage counseling, because some of you may not be married, may not be interested in being married, but I can guarantee you one thing, you're in relationship with somebody. Even if it's just your boss at work, your manager, your friend, somebody. How do I maximize my relationships? Because who you partner with, who you connect with, will have a lot to say about your future. If you hook up with the right person, you might end up where you never imagined you would end up. Hook up with the wrong person, pull you back 2-3 years. Somebody felt that. So I've been teaching for 2 weeks now, but I want you to grab your Bibles. I'm not nearly done. I could probably teach this for months. But don't worry, I'm not. 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. 1 Corinthians chapter number 13, just for a moment. Right now we're in one service, so I'm kind of loving this. I'm not so pressed and rushed. Yeah. I promise you I won't keep you all day. We'll be done in at least 3 hours. At least 3 hours. For all my visitors, that's a joke, I promise you. That's a joke. The visitors sitting here like, I won't be here in 3 hours. Are you ready? The Bible says, I want you to look closely with me. If I speak with the tongues of mankind and of angels, but do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy
and know all mysteries and all knowledge. And if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give away all my possessions to charity, and if I surrender my body so that I may glory, but do not have love, it does me no good. Now watch this. Love is patient. Love is kind. It is not jealous. Love does not brag. It is not arrogant. It does not act disgracefully. It does not seek its own benefit. It is not provoked. It does not keep an account of wrong suffered. I had to pause right there. It does not keep an account of wrong suffered. So if I keep bringing up the same old stuff over and over, am I really walking in love? And it does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. It keeps every confidence. It believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Amen. Help me thank God for the Ford family before we go into the word. Thank y'all so much. Before you grab your seats, I want to talk today from the subject, what's love got to do with it? What's love got to do with it? Grab your seats. Grab your seats. What's love got to do with it? Family, I heard it said, and I don't know who said it because it was an anonymous quote. It says, being deeply loved by someone gives you strength, while loving someone deeply gives you courage. We are most alive when we are in love. The only thing that we never get enough of is love. And the only thing we never give enough of is love. There is only one happiness in life, and that's to love and to be loved. I want you to think about that. If you trace everything back, it all comes back to love. Having someone to love and being loved. Oh, to be loved. You got to be old enough to get that. Oh, to be loved is a wonderful thing. But man, to extend love is a marvelous thing. Here's a heavy question. Why are you here this morning? Love brought you here. You say, what do you mean, Pastor? Well, somebody's here because they love God. Somebody's here because they wanted to know more about God, and they wanted to explore that through praise and worship and the exploration of God's word. They wanted to grow. They came here because they love God, and they loved him so much they wanted to grow in the things of God. But there are other people who are here not really because they love God. Other people are here because they love somebody who invited them to come or demanded that they come. Regardless of the fact, it's still love. If mama said, get your butt out of that bed. Oh, you're going to church this morning. You love mama so much that you didn't act up this morning or act out. You got up, got dressed, didn't feel like coming, but still came. Or you love some little girl or some little boy. Well, that's no. Some man, some woman who said, I'm going to church this morning, and you wanted to act real studious and holy-like, and so you said, I'm coming too. Got it? And watch this. Some of you are here because you love yourself. And I'm not talking about with a selfish kind of love, but I'm talking about a love that says, I want to explore myself, that I've pointed fingers at people too much. And I've blamed a lot of people in my life. And I'm now mature enough and in a place and space where I can turn the finger on myself, when I can stand in the mirror and say, what do you bring to the equation? Who are you? How have you grown? How have you matured? Are you matriculating? Are you growing? Are you becoming? what God has destined for you to become. And somebody says, Pastor, give me the word so it can build me, so it can break down barriers and walls and encourage me and educate me and empower me so I can become the best me. It's all love. But I want you to see something. Tina Turner asked the question, what's love got to do with it? Well, the answer is everything. It's not just a secondhand emotion. And watch this. Tina Turner, or whoever wrote this, must have been heartbroken, because they said, who needs a heart when a heart can be broken? And there are people sitting in the room today who are heartbroken, who says, who needs a heart? I'm not going to be emotional anymore. I'm not going to let down my barriers. I'm not going to let down my wall. The last time I trusted somebody, and the last time I was vulnerable, I got hurt. But here's the thing that most people miss. As wonderful as love is, you can't participate unless you're vulnerable. Unless you let down your walls. Unless you let down your guards. Unless you let somebody in. So for some people, we got to build them back up, because the last relationship broke them bad. It hardened their heart. Remember a point in my life, I said, I don't want any more friends. I'm good with who I got. These ride or die boys I got right here. But here's a heavy question. If I don't let anybody else in, how can God bless me beyond the extent that I'm already blessed? Y'all quiet in this Christian church. Now watch it. I want you to see this. The Bible makes it plain that love is the foundation for everything, and everything hinges on love. Funny thing about the foundation is, the foundation in the foundation is the strength of the building. But the problem is, it's rarely seen. Nobody thinks about it. Nobody talks about it. Nobody praises it. Nobody says, boy, this building must have a wonderful foundation. Look, it's holding up a lot. And there are many people in the room, watch this, who feel like an old building who's been holding up a lot, that's never praised, that's never glorified, that's never spoken well of, that's never spoken into, but always expect you to hold it up. I'm going to help you in a minute. But there are some people that come to you and you say, why do you keep coming to me? Because you can carry it as if you don't have moments of lapses. If you like, you don't have weak moments, down times, frustrations, disappointment, hurts. They just keep dumping stuff on you because you've proven that you can carry stuff. But I don't really want to carry yours too. And if we're going to be in a relationship, I don't really want a one-sided relationship where you dump all your stuff on me. People, watch this. When you get a gift, like I can speak, so they'll call, I'll go places. They'll be like, just put him up there. He'll have something to say. He'll have something to say. Yeah, can you come here and do this, do that. And the other. Never consider him, maybe he's got some weight. Maybe she's got some weight. Maybe they've got some weight. I'm going, watch this. The Bible says it's the hinge. The thing about the hinge is, the hinge gets no praise. It's been swinging that door for 50 years. Watch this. Who in your life has been a hinge for you, you haven't even said thank you to? Who in your life helped you carry weight? I'm coming. Watch this. The foundation. The first part of foundation says load bearing. The other part of foundation says the underlying basis or principle. So love is like the foundation. It holds everything together. but his presence is rarely noticed. Some of you tomorrow are going to go to a job you hate because of people you love. Why would you go to a job you hate? Because I got people at home I love. And I love them so much, I'll go to a job I hate. Come here, man. There are people right now sitting in a loveless, lifeless relationship because of people that they love. There are people sitting in many places that they don't want to be because of people that they love, enduring stuff they wouldn't have endured had it not been for the people that they love. Love is a wonderful thing, and it's a powerful thing. Al Green says it'll make you come home early. And on the same token, it'll make you stay out late. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Love and... Y'all don't... I thought y'all just knew Amazing Grace. I thought y'all, guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. Watch what's funny. Here it is. I want to show you something. It's actually love that makes us holy. There are a lot of people who say they're holy, but don't have love. They shout over the church. But mean as a rattlesnake. I'm coming. Watch. The Bible says it right here. He says, I can speak with the tongues of mankind and angels, but if I do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. So I can pray the walls down, but if I don't have love, I'm just noisy. I can have the gift of prophecy and revelation and mysteries and knowledge and all of these things. I can have faith to move mountains, but if I don't have love, I am nothing. And if I give all my stuff away, I give all my stuff to the poor. And if I surrender my body, but don't have love, it does me no good. So it must be love that makes a difference. Which means, don't get me wrong, that morality is important. Integrity is important. But watch this. You got to have love because you can do the right stuff. You cannot smoke, drink, run around, and still not operate in love. Here's the thing. Watch this. I want you to get this. We all talk about love, but why is it so hard for us to define love? I'm going. Just give me a minute. I have sat before hundreds of couples. I don't know how many hundreds. In the last 18 years, and I have asked them all to define love, and the vast majority of them struggle greatly to define the four-letter word, love. Most people begin the statement with, it's like. It's like a feeling. It's like it was kind of like it's kind of like a person who got your back. You know, it's kind of like. So I want you to think about it before you laugh at them, because if I ask you to define it. It's like it's kind of sort of. I mean, what do you want her to do? If she loves you, how does she love you? How does he love you? Well, now I kind of want to have my back. I kind of, you know. No, it's hard to define. It's hard to define. Well, it's a feeling, you know, it's a feeling. It's a struggle to define, especially in our vernacular, because we don't differentiate between types of love. Everything is just love. I love you, love my wife. At the same time, how could I use the same word? Just think about this. To say I love my wife and then on the same token say I love pizza. Could pizza be on a level with my wife? Well, but I use the same term. You love your, I love my house, love my dog, love my shoes, love my, but everything is not on the same level because I would give up my house for my wife and my dog and a whole bunch of other stuff. So in our society, it's hard to define. In the Greek, they got four different types of love. They got phileo, where you get the word Philadelphia, the type of brotherly love. That's my brother. That's my sister. That's brother. That's sibling. That's love that we have. Storge, that type of love that we have for one another, brothers and sisters too. That agape love, that unconditional love, and that eros, that sexual type of love that couples have for one another. And so they'll break it down and kind of define it and use it differently so that you have an understanding of what it means in their society. But in our society, it's just love. In every definition of love, I mostly hear, even in the dictionary, when I looked it up, it said it's a feeling. And watch this, I don't deny that feeling is involved. I'm not trying to debunk that. But I do think if you just call love a feeling, that your definition is incomplete and inaccurate to a certain degree. Because love can't just be a feeling, because feelings change. And if your feelings change, do you still love me? So if I make you mad, if I say something you don't like, do you still love me? If you don't feel like doing that day, do you still love me? So love not only is just a feeling, but it's got to be in action. Because the Bible says right here that it's patient, that it's kind, that it is not jealous, that it does not brag, it's not arrogant, it does not act disgracefully, it does not seek its own, does not keep a record of wrong, rejoices in the truth. That all sounds like action stuff to me. So I can't just have ooey-gooey, cheer bump feelings, because there's some days when I come home from work tired, I don't feel ooey-gooey. But there are things that still need to be done. There are days when you come home that you don't feel like all that. Y'all gonna just leave me out here by myself? Watch this. There are days you don't feel in love. You're a Christian. There are days you don't feel saved. Tell me I'm not telling the truth. There's some days you fly off the handle and you say, Lord, today wasn't a good day. And so the days that you don't feel in love, but love still does. Love will make you do stuff you don't want to do. Love make you go to work when you really want to stay at home. Love will make you forgive when you really want to hold a grudge. Love will make you. Walk in the mall holding hands with somebody when you said, I'll never walk in the mall holding no hand with nobody. Love how you kissing people in public. Love will make you give up a Corvette so your kids can go to school. Love will make you sacrifice stuff that you didn't really want to sacrifice for people that you care about deeply. How many brothers in this room right now, if you didn't have college tuition, could have a Corvette? How many sisters in this room right now, you could have some nicer purse than you got right now, but you gave it up? You could have a nice house. You could have a nice a lot of stuff, but love made you help some kid that's an adult, but not quite an adult, helping them transition, helping them buy furniture. You already got furniture. Y'all all right? Watch it. Love is an action. So I do believe that there's feeling involved. I feel love. But if there's no action involved, is it really love? I don't want to go too deep today, but if you say you love me but hurt me, if you say you're going to be with me but ain't, we're just talking, aren't we? If when we got married I was fine, but I got a little flabby. And now you looking at folks who fine. Do you love, did you love me or did you love my figure? Did you? When we got together, I had money, had a little debacle. Now you did. Did you love me or what I could do for you or what? But I think it's feeling and then it's course action. Love's got to endure. Love endures some stuff. Get sick, you going to be there? Through sickness and in health. You said to death, do we part? Are you going to be there? Till I die or till I can't provide? Or what? Or until I lose my figure? Or until I... Come here. But in there too, I think there got to be some feeling, of course, and action. But I think to have complete love, I really think there need to be some like. Because I found out you could love people but not like them. You can love people but don't want to be around them. I love you. I want nothing but the best for you. I don't want you to get hurt. I don't want nothing to fall on your head. I wish the best for you, but I really don't want to be around you like that. I'm just saying. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I love you, but from afar. Just so I don't want to be loved from afar. I really want to be liked. I want to be liked and loved. And that's one of my goals for my wife and I, to like each other. For the car to pull up and I say, yes, not, oh, God. I thought I had at least 2 more hours before you showed up. I'm going to put a camera in my house and record my wife's reaction when my car pulled in the garage. Now I'm just flipping. So it's got to be some like. I want us to like each other. Yeah. Do you like each other? Friends, you ought to like each other. Relationship. You're in a relationship with somebody. You ought to at least like them. Like to be around them. Like their company. But here's, I want to go deeper. Why is love so hard to define? But even deeper, why is love so hard to decipher? Why is love so hard to decipher? What do you mean, Pastor? Once again, I've set countless couples before me, and many of them in the midst of bitter arguments and disagreements. Yet when I ask them, do they love each other? They vehemently, enthusiastically say yes. Well, why is love so hard to decipher? How can you fight like cats and dogs? But there be love. You love each other. Then why are y'all fighting like that? I'm not pointing fingers. I'm going to help you understand it. But I want you to think about that. If we love each other, why are we fighting so much? How do we get to a place of not only normalcy, but agreement? Even with some of your friends, your relationship is just, it's just cantankerous. I mean, it's just... Every time we get there, we arguing, why is it so hard to decipher? We say we love each other. I'm going to help you. Because many people are on a crazy cycle. I talked about it not long ago. I'm going to remind you of it just in case you forgot and just in case somebody new here. The crazy cycle. Any relationship that's struggling right now, I can almost guarantee you, especially marriages, you're on the crazy cycle. What's the crazy cycle? It's when the wheels of the relationship are turning in the wrong direction. Because, watch it, there's no love, or there's no respect, or there's no love or respect. The Bible says very plainly, I read it last Sunday, I think it was Ephesians chapter 5, go on down toward the end, start around 20 and read all the way down to the bottom. The Bible says that a man should leave his father and mother and the two shall become one. Now, this is heavy. I ask all my married couples that I counsel, I ask them this, and I want you to get this. The Bible says that a man should leave his father and mother. Why did it say that the woman should leave? And for all of you who know it, don't answer because I taught you that. Don't even try. Watch this. The Bible says that a man should leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife. The word joined right there means stuck like glue, like crazy glue, super glue. Gorilla glue. I like that. Thank you. You ain't getting that gorilla glue loose. You're going to tear something up trying to get that loose. And that's what people don't understand, though. Watch this. Just think about this. If you got gorilla glue and you got two things stuck together, and the only way you can pull them apart is that you tear a piece of the other thing. And that's how relationships are. When you tear relationships apart, both of y'all lose pieces of you. You get that? You're supposed to stick like glue. It says a man should leave his father and mother. It doesn't say the woman. Let me tell you why. I wish I had my umbrellas. I would give you an illustration. That a man's job is to raise, watch this, and cover his kids. Cover his kids. I would need a couple of them. It's okay. He would cover his kids. Cover his kids. Now watch this. And he's supposed to raise his son up to be a covering. He's supposed to be the covering for his daughter. Let me tell you how it's supposed to work. On the other side, when his son or his daughter gets married to somebody else, on the other side, a father and a mother are supposed to be the covering of their kids. Now watch this. And so now, let's say that their daughter wants to marry their son. What happens is that this dad is her covering. So now what has to happen is when he walks her down the aisle, he's bringing her to another covering. Now watch this. Watch this. That's why I ask the question, when I marry you, who gives this woman to be married to this man? And the father typically will say, I do. What he's saying is, I've been her covering. And now I give her to another covering so that she's never uncovered. That's why a man should leave, because he now leaves his covering of his father and becomes his own covering and now covers his family. And he says, I got y'all. I got y'all. I got y'all. I got y'all. Don't worry about nothing. I got y'all. I heard a bump. I heard a bump. You heard a bump? Oh, stay right there, baby. I'll be back. I got it. I got this. I got this. I got this. I got this. Baby, they got a bill collector on the phone. Hold on, I got it. Go ahead. I got it. Hello? I got it. I got it covered. I got it. I got it. Baby, life hard on me. Fall back on me. I got you. I got you. I've got you. We're going to walk this thing out together. When I got some student loans. We got student loans. What you got, now I got. I don't know if y'all ready for that. Here it is. So let me see if I can get through it. So crazy cycle, it tells the man, love your wife. Tells the wife, see to it that you respect your husband. Why does it tell them that? Why does it say to the wife to respect, to the husband to love? Because whenever a man loves, a woman feels respected. Whenever a wife respects, a man feels loved. Y'all all right? So for every brother in the room, watch this. What he wants is respect. Because when I'm respected, I feel loved. A lot of brothers, if you respect them, you don't even have to tell them you love them. And for a lot of sisters, if you tell her you love her, you never got to say, I respect you. Because in her heart, you got to respect me if you love me right. But how do I love you right? What time is it? Watch this. Watch this. Y'all say that, then you're going to talk about me. Here's a heavy question. Here's a heavy question. Is this good? How can two people be in a relationship and they are really trying? Y'all ready? Come, ladies. They're going to help me out. They're really trying, but they're making no progress. What I found is in a lot of relationships, y'all ain't got to look at them. Look at me. They coming. It's funny. When people move in church, I'm preaching, and somebody walks down the aisle, everybody do like this. Now watch this. They're going to help me out. They're going to help me out. Because you're speaking different languages. Everybody has a love language. A love language is the way that they interpret love. It's the way that they construe love. But what if I'm talking to you and I'm trying to love you, but I'm not speaking your language? And what if you're talking to me and you're trying to communicate love to me, but you're not speaking my language? We could be two hardworking people trying to love each other. Still don't feel loved. It's like this. When you're working hard to love somebody and you don't know their language and they don't know your language, it's like this. Now watch this. I'm gonna explain what's about to happen. They're about to sing a song, and Nonika's going to sing a song too. But they're going to sing different songs at the same time. They're both going to try hard. Let's see how it turns out. Let's go. Now, let me ask you a question. If that would have been praise and worship this morning, how many of y'all would have shouted? Been no shouts this morning. We'd have been on Facebook. Man, Rose Hill praise and worship was horrible. I don't know what happened. I don't know if somebody didn't go. They went to the game, didn't get no sleep. I don't know. Harp. But watch this. Now you got all these different people. But I want y'all to sing the same song together and harmonize. Make it sound good. Keep going. Now, how marvelous was that? It was wonderful. Why? Because they were all singing the same song. They were playing the same song. They were all on the same tempo, all at the same time. Yeah. Thank you. Y'all may be seated. I Watch this. Tell me what time it is for real. Okay. All right. All right. I told you, I got more notes than I got time. So, Gary Chapman wrote this wonderful book. Chapman wrote this book called The Five Love Languages. To teach people how to communicate to the other person in their language. Because, watch this, if you work to satisfy your spouse and your spouse works to satisfy you, you have two satisfied people. If your friend works to satisfy you and you work to satisfy your friend, if you work to satisfy your kid has a love language. Your wife has a love language. Your husband has a love language. Your male son has a love language. Your daughter has a love language. And watch this. You might have to speak 3 or 4 different languages in one house. So what you say to your wife or what you do with and for your wife may not be what you have to do with and for your daughter or for your son. You got to speak different languages to all of them. And then she has to be able to speak, or the other person has to be able to speak to you. You get that? Now watch it quickly. Let me see if I can run through this. The first love language is words of affirmation. It's words. Love is patient. One of the ways you show your patience is through your words. Would you just come on here? Got all day? God, dog, every time we go. Every time we go somewhere. Waiting on. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't speed up. You should speed up. Watch this, though. Words of affirmation. Words that speak into a person's life. Words that speak into a life. There are some people here, they need words. And the challenge is when you're married to a man or a woman who's quiet, who works hard and provides, but doesn't give you words. And says that my provision, my providing should be evidence that I love you. When you're thankful for the provision, but you need the words. It's amazing. I wish I had time. I would take you to Mark chapter 9. Jesus encounters this man after he comes down from the mountain transfiguration. The disciples are talking to a man. Jesus comes down and comes up on him and says, what are you talking to them about? What are you talking to my disciples about? The man says, I brought my son to your disciples. My boy's got a problem. He has seizures. He foams at the mouth. He said, I don't know what's going on with him. I brought him to your disciples, and they couldn't heal him. They tried all the stuff that you do, but unsuccessfully, which means that routine doesn't equate to power. Jesus says, bring him to me. Wish I had time to read it. The boy, watch this, when he gets in Jesus' presence, long story short, the boy starts having seizures, having these fits. And Jesus is asking questions. He's talking, using his words. He says, how long has this been going on? The man has a dialogue with him. And the man says to Jesus, if you can do anything, if you can make it a little better. Jesus says, all things are possible to him that believes. In other words, I can do for you to the extent that you believe I can. Now, I ain't come to preach that, but that's a message for somebody. And now Jesus speaks a word over the boy, and the boy pines out like he's dead. Jesus picks him up. But he heals him, and Jesus performs a lot of miracles, watch this, with just words. Not even a touch. Miracle with words, which shows that your words have miracle properties if they're used correctly. Because you and I are categorized as one of two things. Either you are a builder or a breaker. You use your words to build people up or break people down. Ooh, I felt a chill. And if we have to ask the question, which are you? And you have to honestly reply, what would you be? Now, we're all builders and breakers sometimes. You say what you want. But the majority of the time, are you building the person that you say you love? That kid, or are you conditioning that kid? Limiting that kid? Oh, it got heavy in here. It got heavy. Are you speaking into your wife? Speaking into your husband, telling them how great they are, what potential they have in them. You can do it. Yes, you can. I don't care what they say. I don't need them to agree. Long as we agree. But, or are you a part of they? Like they say, oh, you can't do that. Or you become a they bird too. And so a person who needs words needs somebody to speak into them. You will buy them the greatest gift and they'll say, thank you. But you'll give them a word and they'll be like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. That touched my soul. You like that $500 didn't touch your soul? No, not like the words did. Not like the words did. Y'all all right? The next one is quality time. Quality time. Some people's love language is quality time. If you're not spending quality time with them, then they don't feel loved. I don't care what you do. You could wash the clothes, you could cut the trees outside, cut the grass, you can do all that stuff, but you don't have time for me. Yeah, you're always busy. But I'm doing stuff for the house. I'm cutting the grass. Yeah, but what about me? And sometimes that can seem a bit selfish. You got me? But what about me? My love language. And watch this. When both of you, everybody should take the quiz. You find out what it is. Then you realize, I'm not selfish. That's how I interpret love. I interpret love through words. I interpret love through quality time. Quality time is uninterrupted time between the two of you. No cell phone. And we got to stop. We're all guilty of scrolling. We sitting there talking, scrolling, checking this, that. And watch this. These phones have us addicted. You look around, got it in your hand. You're like, why do I even have it in my hand? And now you're spending more time with it than her. It than him. Here's a good trial for all of us. At the end of the week, you get a FaceTime report. You get a report of how much screen time you use. Now, when you see how much screen time you use, think about how much time you've invested in somebody you say you love. And see if they jive. 6-8 hours of FaceTime, 15 minutes of quality time. And watch it. Your time is your most valuable asset. And so who and what you give your time to speaks a lot about who you love. Uh-oh, let me get out of here. There's a scripture in text where Jesus heals a blind man. They bring the blind man to Jesus. I love the text because of what Jesus did. They bring the blind man to Jesus. Jesus says, all right, good, thank you. Grabs him by the hand, pulls him out of the city, and walks away and begins to interact with him alone. Quality time. Alone time. Jesus says, thanks for bringing him. But in order to perform a miracle in his life, I'm going to have to spend time with him. He doesn't just need a word. He's not like the centurion, the soldier who says, don't come to my house. I'm not worthy. Just send the word. So for some people, the word is good. But for other people, I need time. Preaching better than you're shouting. I need time. I need you to divorce yourself of all the stuff that you have going on to show me that I'm important. Take me out. Do something special with me. You don't have to spend a lot of money. Spend some time. 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 We got time to get through them. Watch this. Physical touch. Physical touch. Other people communicate through physical touch. A lot of men are physical touch people. Physical touch. Now watch this. But here's what I don't want you to do. I don't want you to limit physical touch to just sexual stuff. Yeah. Because I know a lot of women who scored high on the physical touch part, and it wasn't because they wanted so much the sexual part. They just liked their partner's touch. Hug me, hold my hand, embrace me, cuddle with me sometimes. And the church said, amen. Amen. Yeah. And so if I had time to teach you, I would show you that those little touches when you touch him and you clowning, y'all laughing. Ha, boy, you crazy. You touch. He likes that. He likes that. He likes to be touched. She likes to be touched. She's in the kitchen. Walk up behind her, hug her. She likes that. She likes to be touched. She likes to be touched. But the problem with men is, as soon as she responds, trying to take her out the kitchen. When she say, dude, I just can't. All right. I said I wasn't going to talk about that too much today. Now watch it. And so, the touching part is important. Meaningful touch. This woman walks up to Jesus, touches the hem of his garment, and virtue flows from him from a touch, which means that, watch this, when you touch people, virtue flows. Oh. That energy flows, that there's a power in your touch. There's a power in your embrace. And for a person who needs the touch, the words are great, but they need the power of an embrace, power of a hold my hand sometimes. Do. And what happens is, watch this. Everybody listen to me, because I don't know the next time I'm going to get back to this. When you don't have that same love language, then you get tired of it. God, why I always got to be holding your hand? Why you always got to be touching on me? God. Because it's not your love language. Or why we always got to talk? You know me. We go in there and talk. Do my best talking. But then you have a woman who loves talk, but her husband works hard and she never touches him. And he's like, man, she don't love me. Man, what do you mean? Man, she does all the stuff, keep the house nice. Yeah, but she don't touch me. She don't touch me. And then when we do go to that place in the night, she always tired. Can I just say one thing and I'll move? Now go on. Watch this. She don't touch me. When she does, she's not really into it. She just does it just to satisfy me quickly, but it's not, her heart's not in it. Heart's not in it. And I can tell. When she cooked today, she cooked with love, but when she's with me, I didn't feel no love. I felt love for the kids, love for everybody else she encountered, but when it was my turn, she was out of love. Y'all all right? Why I always got to get the leftovers? That's how men feel. Why I always got to get the leftovers? So you go out and give everybody, and then I'm stuck with the leftovers. And she says, why you eat the leftovers in the fridge? He says, I eat leftovers all the time. I'm moving. I got two more. Come on. You ready? Gifts. Next love language is gifts. And people think people who love gifts are materialistic people. And they just want stuff. They just want stuff. And sometimes people can be. But when you're in a relationship and a person really enjoys getting gifts, oftentimes, here's what you can tell the difference. It's not about the value of the gift. It's about the thought put into the gift. And so you can go to the Circle K and come back with her favorite candy bar. And she'd be, "Whoo, you got me a candy bar?" Because in her mind, you were doing something and I didn't ask you for anything, but you thought about me. And the gift is a sign that you thought about me. You thought about me. It's a gift. It's a gift. And so people don't understand that. And here's the best way for every person in the room so that you can become a great gift giver. You'll never be a great gift giver until you become a good listener. Because you'll be like my wife. I always ask her, "What do you want?" She said, "I don't know. I don't know. I don't want nothing. Don't need nothing." But I'll listen in conversation and she'll say, "I like that. I like that." And so I'm taking notes. So when it becomes birthday, Mother's Day, I'm going to come in with something. She'll be like, How did you know I wanted this?" Because I was listening. I was listening. Instead of some gift out of left field that you just thought, "I hope she like it. She'll probably like it." Why not listen and get her something you know she'll like? Or listen and get him something you know he'll like. He'll like. Instead of buying him some necktie he don't like, get him a fishing pole. Let him listen to him for a season. You don't like fishing, but listen for a second. What that thing was, a ZX10 rod and reel cat? Oh, yeah. Go to Bass Pro. "Hey, you got one of them ZX?" Gift. Even Jesus liked gifts. A lady showed up with an alabaster box, broke it, poured it on Jesus. And then all the people were complaining and saying that that was too expensive. That could have been given to the poor. And Jesus says, "No, she's done a good thing. She's done a good thing. She's done a good thing." And let nobody make you feel guilty for blessing people you love. And finally, I'm going home. Acts of kindness. Acts of kindness is making that person's life better. If you have an acts of kindness, husband, wife, then you're going to have to do things that remove stress, that remove tension, and they'll appreciate that. That's why a lot of men don't get this. A lot of women, I find, and everything is, you know, you got people in every category that fall. You got men who like acts of service. They got women. But I find that a lot of women like acts of service. Through my studies, I just found that a lot of women like acts of service. A lot of men like to be touched. So, what do you do? That's why, men, if we start doing a little housework, some extra stuff, make her life a little easier. Yeah, wash the dishes sometimes. She don't have to do that. You know what I'm saying? Vacuum, do some stuff. As she comes home, she'd be like, "Oh, you did that? I was going to, oh, wow. Oh, wow. That's great." Now I lost all the men. Crank that vacuum up sometime, baby. Get that mop. Get busy. Do some stuff to make her life easier. And watch this. If you make her life easier, then on the other side, you'll get blessed because now her mind is not occupied by what she has to do. I think I could do this for a living. You think so? So acts of service. Watch this. Jesus is coming to the cross. He's laboring. He's falling with the cross. Man, Simon picks up the cross for Jesus, carries his cross. "Least I can do is, I'm not going to die for you, but I'll make your journey a little easier." And every now and then, If you see your spouse struggling, let me carry it for a while. Let me handle it for a while. Take a break. Let me handle it for a while. I got it. Hey, you go get your nails done. I got the kids. I'm cool. I got it. You go. Do your thing. Let me carry some weight for you. It's funny. Just popped in my mind. One time we were coming through an airport, me and Sherman, Lady Sherman, and my sister-in-law Chandra, my brother-in-law Lee, we were coming through the airport, and it was Chandra's birthday, I think it was, and we had this big old cheesecake from the Cheesecake Factory. And man, we were running late for our flight, and so we were almost about to miss it. So we were running through the airport in Atlanta trying to get to our flight, but that cheesecake was heavy. I'm serious, like really heavy. And so what we'd do is we'd run for a while, and we'd say, here, your turn, you carry for a while. And then somebody else would carry it while we're running, then we'd pass it off, your turn. And we were sharing the weight. Now, if we would have left that cheesecake on one person, that person would have been miserable. And everybody else would have been bouncing around happy. And that one person would have been miserable. But because we shared the weight, we were equally happy and equally satisfied. Because watch this, there's satisfaction in carrying weight. But there's no satisfaction in being overburdened. Is that all right? All right. What's love got to do with it? It's everything. And what most people want to do is invest some time to learn things like this so that they can make their love better. Don't grab a book. Don't watch a documentary. For all you young people who are on the cusp of getting married and want to get married one day, start learning some stuff about yourself so that when you get ready to get married, say, listen, here, let me just go ahead and tell you here, this is what I'm going to need. I like words. See if you can handle my resume before we even start getting too serious. But my prayer is, as I close, is that some couple was sitting here and said, yeah, I kind of slipped in that area. I got to make some adjustments in that area. Well, he's right. He's right. And here's what we do. Here's what we do. To close it out, thank you, Holy Spirit, for bringing that back. We often give the other person what we need and get frustrated when they don't like it. Think about it. For every man who likes touch, he wants to touch his wife and can't figure out why you don't like to be touched. What is wrong with you? Jeez, if you did that to me, I would be head over here. But that's... And then a woman, she wants to talk, so she talks and talks and talks. He's like, oh, my God. She's like, I don't understand why you don't want to talk. Talking is great for you. Acts of service or whatever. And so we pour it on other people and try to figure out why they don't like it. We don't speak the same languages. Now, I've had some couples that have been blessed to be high in the same areas, which makes life really easy. And I think that's why a lot of couples get along really easily, because they're very, very compatible in those areas and they don't have to work hard to show the other person that they love them. But some people are not blessed like that. You got to do some work, some study. You got to find out. You got to give your kids a test and find out what they need. Because even your kids, think about it now, they don't need the same thing. Some of your kids want to talk. Some of your kids don't ever want to talk. They just want money. Can you just give me some money? No, I should stand to your feet. I'm done. Give God a hand clap of praise. Was that helpful? Yeah? All right. Good. I'm going to pray for you, and then Elder Rob's going to come. He's going to do communion, do the Holy Communion. Thank you for your patience. Just trying to get through some of this before the year is over. I want you to hear this. Father, how we thank you and how we honor you, how we lift you up. Magnify your name. You are truly greatly to be praised. And Lord, as we assemble ourselves here today, we say, God, if there's any person here who does not have a relationship, let them come today. Say, I want to be in relationship with a God like that. If there's one here today who needs to rededicate their life or be a member of our church, God, give them the courage and boldness to do it right now, to take that step of faith, to realize that without action, man, there won't be any change. So, Father, we thank you in advance. And, Father, as we prepare to take what represents your blood and your body, God, bless us. We thank you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? Amen. Come on, Elder Rob.
Come on, let's thank God.
I'm so glad your love will stay, 'cause I love you, and you show me, Jesus.
Is there another?
What it really means to love.
Amen. Our last and final appeal. Is there one? Is there another? Amen. Amen. Come on, let's thank God for our dear sister who has come. Amen. What a blessing. Listen, on behalf of our senior pastor and teacher, Pastor Dan M. Donaldson, Senior Lady Sherman, and the entire Rosehill family, we just want to say welcome. We thank God for you. You are truly the answer to our prayers. Come on, let's make her feel welcome once again. Amen. Listen, our leaders are going to take you to the back and love on you, give you whatever you need. Amen. Amen. Come on, family. Let's thank God for that word. What's love got to do with it? Amen. If you would, at this time, let's expose the bread as we get ready to commune. Amen. For the final time this year. Amen. Amen. The Lord has allowed us to see December. Amen. December 2022. Come on, you have to thank God for that. He kept you all year long. Amen. We've been through some ups and downs. We've lost some people along the way, but the Lord has kept you. If you don't have communion, come on, slip that hand up. Our leaders will get you one as quickly as possible.
The blood that Jesus shed for me. Oh, way back on Calvary. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power.
Amen. Bible says that night when he was with his disciples, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it. He says, take, eat, this bread represents my body, which will be given for you. And they did eat. Hey, man, if you would, expose the juice. In that same manner, he took the wine. He says that this wine represents my shed blood for you, and they did drink. Amen. Come on, somebody shout, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. You may be seated.
It will never
is high. Come on, y'all know that?
Oh,
to let that one go. Well, family, it is giving time. Come on, let's get excited to give. Amen. Listen, here at Rose Hill, we make it very simple for you. There are three different ways you can give. Of course, you can text to give. The short code is 84321. Hit that send button. If it's your first time doing it, it'll send you some information to fill out. But many of us have been doing it now for a few years, and it's quite simple to do it that way. Amen. I like it because if I get paid on a Wednesday, I can go ahead and pay my tithes and offerings. I don't have to worry about holding on to it. Amen. Of course, you can go to our website, rosehillchurch.org, and give that way. And then last but not least, you can grab an envelope right there in front of your seat and fill out your gifts that way. We appreciate all of them. You guys have been so faithful when it comes to your giving. Please don't forget about our One campaign as we continue to give toward our new building. We were there on the property praying on yesterday, and we had a wonderful time. Amen. Praying in the rain. Amen. What a blessing. What a blessing it was. So we'll give you a few seconds to fill out your gifts, and we'll be right back to pray over them. Hey man, come on, lift your phone, envelope, however you're giving. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you blessed us with another opportunity to sow into good soil. Father, as we sow our seeds, we thank you in advance for the harvest that shall come our way. We speak it now. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Listen, a couple of brief announcements while you are giving. Amen. Please listen to these announcements. You can be a blessing by bringing unwrapped toys to the church for children ages between 5 and 14 years old. We will be accepting gifts all the way up until December the 16th for our toy drive. So let's be a blessing to someone else who may not be able to buy toys for their children on this year. Can we do that? All right. Certificates, foundation class certificates are available. If you completed your foundation classes but you have not received your certificate, you can catch Elder Trostler or Sister Carolyn, or you can grab one of the leaders and we'll point you in the right direction if you have not received your foundation class certificate. Amen. Amen. Let's continue to keep those who have lost loved ones in our prayers. Amen. Pray for the Oliver family, the Tolliver family, rather, also the Johnson family, and homegoing services for Brother Tolliver and Sister Sherry Jean Keller, the aunt of Sister Johnson, will be. Oh, actually, they already have passed. Amen. I'm sorry. But let's keep those families lifted up in prayer. Can we do that? And we're excited that we don't have anybody on the recovery list today. Amen. Amen. Listen, did you enjoy yourself today? Amen. Amen. Come on, stand to your feet. Give your neighbor a pound. Tell them it's so good to see you in the house today. Amen. Amen. Hold your love for just one moment. Listen, family, please remember sometimes during the holiday season, we can put a lot of stress on ourselves by trying to buy our children gifts and put pressure on ourselves for all of that stuff. Let's remember that Jesus is the reason for this season. Amen. And let's not put pressure on ourselves. Don't go in debt and be paying till next December for the gift you bought this December. Let's really make it about Jesus this year, and let's enjoy family fun and fellowship. Amen. Come on, hold your love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this awesome day. We thank you for our senior pastor. We thank you for that powerful word. Now, Lord, as we get ready to leave this place, but never ever your presence, we thank you in advance for your traveling grace. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sovereign God, sovereign.
trust in.